vernacular language with the title Rajgadu Rajayadu that was translated by me. So I have analyzed this play not in terms of its structure but in terms of its language. So India and Indian literature has existed as idea and images in creative writing in the country for centuries, but they began to emerge as critical concepts and tools of comparison probably only in the 19th century, when the Western scholars, inspired by the affinity between European and Indo-Aryan languages, began to study the literatures in Sanskrit, Pali and Prakrit that they called Indian literature. So of course this was a typical distortion, since they took into their account of Indian literature neither the great classical literatures of South Indian Dravidian languages like Tamil and Kannada, nor contemporary literatures in all Indian languages, including the modern Indo-Aryan ones. So this was not an unconscious error. They knew such literatures existed. So but their racial colonial ideology, later identified as Orientalism, would not permit them to admit that the pre-Aryan inhabitants of India could produce any great literature or civilization, or that the subjects of colonial India were capable of producing a literature far more various and richer than their own contemporary literature. So I would place this particular drama into a post-colonial literature. Post-colonial literature is one of the interesting term, I could say. It is supposed, like other subaltern theories of literature, to privilege those who have sentenced by history to subjugation, diaspora and displacement, and empower the marginalized by retrieving the voices, spaces and identities silenced or suppressed by colonial power. So no enterprise can be more desirable than such an act of decolonization accompanied by decanonization. But for all practical purposes, it is the old Commonwealth literature. It is also termed as new literatures, third world literatures, colonial or post-colonial literatures, and you can also call it as native literatures. So it is re-christened, I could say. The title post-colonial embraces, at least in its actually existing form in India, so only Indian writing in English from Raja Rao to Salman Rushdie. So there are several writers and critics in India who argue that an Indian literature does not simply exist, since India does not have a common language. The famous scholar critic Nihar Ranjan Ray once argued that literature is entirely language based, and language as a cultural phenomenon is all but wholly conditioned by its locale and the socio-political forces that have been operating there. So each language, he argued, must have its own specific character of form, style, images, symbols, nuances and association, even its specific themes and contents. Literature, of course, has language-specific qualities, and language is a very decisive element of literature. So however, language is not the sole identity of literature. It has other dimensions: aesthetic, ethical, cultural, civilizational and historical. So the drama which I selected for this study consists of all these aspects of aesthetic, ethical, cultural and civilizational and historical importance too. So all these elements that make literary translations, dialogues and comparisons possible also make literature a largely intertextual and even intercultural phenomenon whose writing and reading alike are controlled by historical forces. Pure aesthetics who turn literary texts into self-sufficient verbal icons may oppose this view, but even careful structural and semiotic analysis, not to speak of cultural critiques, are sure to bring out the extra-linguistic civilizational elements that go into their making. So now I would start analyzing the play in my own perspective. The modernism of the 50s and the 60s was also a pan-Indian shift in sensibility and idiom, as most Indian languages together experienced the trauma of development with its urbanization and the consequent alienation and loss of individual identity. So the concerns now were more ontological than sociological, and the form was foregrounded in an attempt to subvert the existing canons and norms. The developments and after modernism again seems not to be confined to one language or region alone. The Dalit movement, the women's movement, the literature of ecological concerns, all these cut across provincial and linguistic boundaries. So the thoughtless globalization that often looks like a recolonization and the erosion of values in public life make for a common agenda and a common platform for sensitive writers who increasingly feel that the very existence of serious literature is under threat from the market forces. So rooted inextricably in their social, historical and cultural context, Indian writers therefore continue to be first and foremost Indian whatever language they write in. So this basic unity has in no way eroded the fascinating diversity of literature of our times. The local traditions, the rhythms of popular speech, the varying landscapes, ethnic communities with their lifestyles and styles of worship and celebration, folklore and forms of art, the general level of awareness, dissemination of diverse ideologies, different combinations of external influences and native elements, and the particular genius of each language have given our literature specific tones. Considering all these changes in the Indian literature, here is a writer who has chosen the drama as powerful medium of expression and social transformation, has come up with a novel ideas and thought-provoking concepts. When we look at the English theatre from modern perspective, a lot of characteristics of English theatre travel to India. The early 20th century saw a lot of English plays being staged in different parts of India. Indian theatre in the 20th century owes a great deal of ideas and influences from across the continent, from both Europe and America. Both in First and Second World War, idealistic men and women struggled to put across a paper through concerns about the rights and desires of population. The 20th century is about spread of notions of democracy all over the world and its implementation in political governments as well. In India also, people struggled in the formative years of the 20th century with colonialism and our own struggles for independence from British rule. So contemporary Indian drama, deviating from its classical and European models, is experimental and innovative in terms of thematic and technical qualities. So it is not an offspring of any specific tradition, and it has laid the foundation of a distinctive tradition in the history of world drama by reinvestigating history, legend, myth, religion and folklore with context contemporary socio-political issues. So Dr. D. Vijayabhaskar is quite simply the most extraordinary playwright of the 21st century. Bhaskar has extended the boundaries of theatre both thematically and technically. His work is a continuous exploration of changes in society in terms of social conditions, political situations and cultural diversities. He uses both realism and fantasy to work out this task effectively. So Bhaskar's plays deals with external realities of everyday life. Over his 30-year career, he has dealt with a variety of themes of extra-literary importance, such as caste, demarcation, oppression, deprivation, gender issues, marginalization, politics, economy, ethnicity, and so on. So Bhaskar basically is a natural writer. He has the prime novelist gift of involving one so deeply in the desires and frustrations of his characters that one reads with a positive yearning to spend more time with them. He's an active and prolific writer, always restless, moving, probing, testing the limits of the possible and seeking new possibilities, searching for something new always. So Rajagadu Rajayadu is an interesting play by Dr. D. Vijayabhaskar. The play consists of three important features as mentioned by Vadrevu Chinnaveeru Bhattudu. Firstly, this is a work that has inherited the tradition of North Andhra literature. Secondly, it unveils life in the country, wide protests and movements for social justice and inequality. Untouched so far by literature have been touched by him, and a narrative mode lost in the dark folds of epics. And thirdly, this is the new experiment in dramaturgy, intensely relevant to modern needs by past master in the field. So the writer shaped into a play the tale of a man as humble as blade of grass who grows into Garuda, the king of birds, who becomes Shiva to pull the fangs of the vicious tradition and thus lays the foundation for the common man's democracy. The central theme of the play could be the result of the impact of the fight for selfhood, for identity, and for the very existence of the communities who have all along been marginalized. But we must note one thing, that when modernism entered Indian society, Indian society and Indian literature, this modernism may merely have brought relief to some sections, but the result of the relief have been limited to only a few. So I would analyze a few phrases I attempted.